In this video, we introduce the so-called special angles on the unit circle that we need in trigonometry and calculus. And what makes these angles special is that we can quickly calculate exact values of the trigonometric functions at these angles. Now, these aren't the only angles where that's possible, but it's sort of a simplest minimum set of important angles that we should probably remember. So right now, we're looking at a complete picture of every one of these special angles. But I want to emphasize that you shouldn't be dedicating your time to memorizing every detail of this diagram. Instead, you want to have a rough familiarity with the locations of special angles. And what you really want is to have a simple logical process to calculate angles in radians or degrees if you forget exactly where they are. So that's really the point of this video. We're going to walk through a very simple process and some short calculations to construct this diagram. And when you understand that process, there's very little left to memorize. So let's get started on dividing up the circle into all the angles we care about in a typical math class. We're going to start at 0 radians, which is also 0 degrees. And you could argue correctly that this is also 2π radians. In other words, the location we get to after going through one full rotation around the circle. But we're just going to look at our first pass through the circle. So we're going to call that 0 degrees. And we remember the total angle in a circle is 360 degrees, but we can also talk about that as 2π radians. And I'll post a link to the video where we establish that radians are actually the natural unit of angle and the fact that there are 2π of them in a circle. So we're going to start finding special angles by dividing the circle in half. And measuring angle counterclockwise from the positive x-axis, that must be an angle of 180 degrees or π radians. Now all I did there was take the 2π radians for the whole circle and divide it by 2 to get halfway across. Next, we're going to divide the halves in half. So if I look at this point at the top of the circle, that angle is half of 180 degrees, that's 90 degrees, or I could write it as half of π radians, so π/2 radians. And now that we know π/2 is the same thing as 90 degrees, we can get the angle at the bottom of the circle by simply adding 90 degrees to 180 degrees, that's 270, and adding π/2 to π. And this is our first look at the type of fraction math that starts to pop out of this process. In radians, that angle at the bottom is going to be π + π/2. We can get a common denominator on this, and I'll show a little more detail in this first calculation, and call that 2π/2 + π/2, which gives us a grand total of 3π/2. So that's the radian value of that angle at the bottom of the circle. So that's 3π/2, or 270 degrees, depending on how you want to represent it. Now, the next step is probably not surprising. We're going to divide the quarters of the circle in half. And we'll just work our way counterclockwise through these points, starting from the x-axis. So we're starting with this one in the first quadrant. And that angle is half of 90 degrees. That's easy enough. That's 45 degrees. Or we can take π/2 and divide it by 2 to represent this in radians. Well, half of π/2 is π/4. So there's that angle. Now we know that a 45 degree angle is the same thing as π/4. So to get this angle in the second quadrant, all we have to do is add π/4 to π/2, and we'll have the radian measure of that angle. Again, getting a common denominator, this first fraction, π/2, is actually 2π/4. And if I add 2π/4 to π/4, I get 3π/4. In degrees, it's just 90 + 45, which is 135 degrees. And we continue this way around the circle. If I add 45 degrees to 180 degrees, that gives me 225 degrees for this third quadrant point. And in radians, what I'm doing is adding π/4 to get that angle. Pi is 4π/4. So 4π/4 + another π/4, that's 5π/4. So there's that third quadrant angle obtained from this 45 degree manipulation. Finally, we look at our fourth quadrant point, and that's 45 degrees more than 270, which gives us 315 degrees. And the radian measure of this guy is 3π/2 + π/4. And getting a common denominator there, we multiply the top and bottom of the first one by 2. So we get 6/4π. Now when I add these up, I get 7π/4 for that final angle. So there's all the angles we get by dividing the quarters in half. And at this point, we have the whole circle symmetrically divided into 8 pieces. Now, the next thing we're going to do is look for every angle that we can obtain by moving 30 degrees away from one of the cardinal directions. So I mean, I want to move 30 degrees away from an angle of 0, above and below that point, 30 degrees away from straight up, 30 degrees from this left point, 180 degrees, and 30 degrees clockwise and counterclockwise from this bottom point on the circle. This is actually going to complete our set of special angles, but now we have 8 more calculations to do. So this first angle in degrees is going to be 30 degrees because I just moved 30 degrees counterclockwise from the positive x-axis. And then I have to figure out, well, what's 30 degrees in radians? And I know 90 degrees is pi over 2, so a third of that is pi over 6. So there's the angle pi over 6, comma 30 degrees. Now I want to add 30 degrees to that to get to a point of 60 degrees. Or alternatively, you could think of it as subtracting 30 degrees from 90. Either way, you end up in the same spot. But we'll just say it's 30 plus 30, which is 60 degrees. And then in radians, it's going to be pi over 6 plus an additional pi over 6. That gives us 2 pi over 6, which reduces to pi over 3. So now we have a complete set of the first quadrant special angles, and we move on to the second quadrant. I need to go 30 degrees past 90 degrees, which is 120. And in radians, that's pi over 2 plus an additional 30 degrees, which we're now representing as pi over 6. Getting a common denominator there, pi over 2 is 3 pi over 6. So I end up with 4 pi over 6, which then reduces to 2 pi over 3. So there's that angle. And now my next one is 30 degrees past that. Or alternatively, I could just subtract 30 degrees from 180. So just for the sake of variety, I'll do it that way. 180 minus 30 is 150 degrees. And this angle in radians is going to be pi minus pi over 6 because pi over 6 is 30 degrees. Well, that's 6 pi over 6 minus pi over 6, giving me 5 pi over 6 for that angle. And moving on to the third quadrant, I simply add 30 degrees to 180. That gives me 210 degrees. And then in radians, I have pi plus 30 degrees, pi plus pi over 6. That's 6 pi over 6 plus an additional pi over 6, giving me 7 pi over 6 for that angle. And next, again, just for the sake of variety, maybe I'll use subtraction to get this one. So I want 30 degrees less than 270. That's 240. And then in radians, I have 3 pi over 2 minus pi over 6. And we can get a common denominator by multiplying the first one by 3 over 3. So this is 9, 6 pi. So 9 pi over 6 minus pi over 6 gives me 8 pi over 6. Which then reduces to 4 pi over 3. All right, finishing things up in the fourth quadrant, we have 30 degrees more than 270, that's 300 degrees, and pi over 6 more than 3 pi over 2. So just doing the fraction math again, 3 pi over 2 plus pi over 6, and getting a common denominator. On the first one, that's 9 pi over 6, and I end up with 10 pi over 6, which then reduces to 5 pi over 3. And our final angle is going to be 30 degrees more than that, or just to show you that this is possible, we can rename 0 as 2 pi or 360 degrees and subtract from that. Either way, we're going to get the same answer. 30 degrees more than 300 is 330, but 30 degrees less than 360 is also 330. And maybe just because it's more fun this way, I'm going to find this angle in radians by taking 2 pi and then subtracting pi over 6 from it, and getting a common denominator, I'll multiply the first one by 6 over 6, giving me 12 pi over 6. That's the same thing as 2 pi. And then minus pi over 6, so I get 11 pi over 6. So I want to make a quick point about the relative importance of these special angles. These are really here in the math curriculum, because when we evaluate trig functions at these angles, we can do that by drawing two special triangles. One of them is a 45-45-90 triangle, and the other one is a 30-60-90 triangle. So these are just some of the most accessible special angles for doing calculations for practice in a math course. And that's the primary reason they're in math books. But there are some special angles that pop up in real applications very frequently. And it's basically just the cardinal directions. Certainly, you need to know the value of all the trig functions at 0 radians or 0 degrees. Pi over 2 or 90 degrees pops up a lot. Pi or 180 degrees pops up a lot. 3 pi over 2 or 270, not as much. And occasionally, like a pi over 4 will pop out in a real application. Even rarer than that, you might get a pi over 3 or a pi over 6. But in the vast majority of applications, you're not going to be looking at angles that are outside of the first quadrant or other than the cardinal directions. So like I said at the beginning of this video, you absolutely want to prioritize the process of deriving these angles, because that's a simple, logical process and it can get you the angles back even if you forget them. But if you are going to put some time into prioritizing memorization, focus on the first quadrant, because that's what you're going to use most often in real applications. In the next video, we introduce sine and cosine functions, starting with their fundamental definitions, and then moving on to their graphs and their values at the special angles. That video is linked at the upper left, and I'll see you there.